Well, hello. Here I am. On a Friday. On a different day of the week. I think I need a haircut. I can't get these little tufts to not poke out under my headset band. Well, if you're looking at that pre-show setup, I've got fish and chocolate. And that's, bit of a joke. I'm not actually going to combine the fish and the chocolate. I'm going to make two things. I'm still working through the fish from Tuesday's stream for the sushi. I've used up all the salmon. I'm done with the salmon. I've still got some pieces of tuna left. Which is what's sitting there waiting for me. It's coming up to room temperature. Coming up a little bit to room temperature. And also drying the surface out. So I'm going to do a real quick hot sear on it. Get that real thin layer of hard cook on the outside. Bright red inside. That's going to be the entree. We're doing two courses today. Because I'm also making a dessert. My dessert option today is a chocolate mousse. Just yesterday, I think, I was, another streamer, Salberry, was talking about chocolate mousse and how easy it is to make, and I've never made it, and I was thinking back, and I'm not sure I've ever eaten it either. So I've got a recipe, chocolate mousse for one. I'm going to make one serving for myself. Well, chocolate mousse for one egg, because it calls for eggs. So that I'm not making a big batch. I'm making as little as I can based on a single egg. So I'm following the recipe for that. Our entree is also going to be cream-based. Well, no, it's gonna be pasta. We'll see as it comes together. I keep looking over here. I should put a face camera over here because I face this way a lot. But yeah, we've got. I don't think any of these things are going to be terribly time-consuming today. The dessert needs to chill a bit, so I'm going to do that first, and then it can rest in the fridge and chill while I work on the entree. And then it'll be ready when I'm done eating afterwards. It'll be able to take pictures of it, but I won't be able to dig into it until afterwards. So that's our plan. Dessert, make dessert first, then make dinner, then eat dinner, then eat dessert. I don't think this is going to take incredibly long to get through, but we'll see, I guess. I've never done either of these things successfully. I've tried doing seared tuna. I ended up cooking it through, so we're going to try to be real gentle with it. There'll be a moment of truth when I cut into it and see if it's still ready. Otherwise, yeah, I've got all the bits and pieces here already, so I don't I'm kind of chattering so people can filter in, so people can see my go live message. I've got Tiny Whisk today. I think the Tiny Whisk is going to end up being used because I need a small whisk to beat the egg white. And I think his buddy Tiny Blue Whisk, or medium-sized Blue Whisk, will probably be employed for the cream. Anyways, let's get us back over to the countertop. Tuna is just sitting on the side, resting. Like you would with a steak, I'm bringing it up to temperature so it isn't fridge cold when it hits the pan later. Also, so the surface can dry out a little bit. Because that'll help the. I'm going to put crust on the outside of it. That'll help the crust stick to the outside of it. Anyways, as I said, I've got a recipe here. So pulling up my recipe. Hi, Felix. Welcome in. We're going to do two whisks, and I'm thinking that I need two separate whisks, but they're both here. So let me pull out my recipe panel so I can both see it and chat. As before, let me know about the sound balance. I didn't change anything, so it should be the same as it was, but you never know. OBS had to update today, so I don't know, lost all my settings or something. Anyway, step one is actually going to be over on the stove, because I need to melt part of the chocolate. But before I melt the chocolate, I need to chop the chocolate. So let's use a lot of different cutting boards for this. We'll use our standard wood cutting board. Fortunately for me, I found chocolate on sale because it's expired one day ago. So they were like, oh, get rid of it quick. So that was good. So I got to buy the nicer chocolate. I could eat this chocolate. Chocolate and tuna. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Wow, it comes with pre-stamped little divisions that have amount markers on them. Each of these little squares is a quarter ounce. That's incredibly convenient. Amazing. So I need, per my recipe, 3 ounces of chocolate, which is that much chocolate. Oh, it just pops. I probably could break it with my fingers, even. Yeah, I could. Not the small ones, just the big. The divisions were slightly different depths, and the deeper ones you could snap with your fingers, and the shallower ones need the knife. It's a new month. Happy April, everyone. So chopping up the chocolate is because I'm melting the chocolate. So it needs to be in small enough pieces that it melts relatively evenly before any parts of it start to burn. This would be a good time for chips, but you can't really find... You can find them. They exist. Nice chocolate chips, but they're less abundant than a nice bar chocolate. And this one was on sale, so... It's amazing what you can find on sale when you go looking for it. I bought a spare bar as well. I could try another chocolate recipe in the future since it was on sale. We're going to do the proper technique with this. Let's see, I need to make sure it fits inside the pot that I'm going to be using. double boiler. Like so. There's just a glass bowl over top of a saucepan. We'll boil water in the saucepan, which will heat up the bowl and control the heating so that it doesn't, because the pan will end up being hotter than the melting point of chocolate. It could easily burn the chocolate. But put water in between. Water boils at exactly 100 degrees, and it stops increasing in temperature while it's boiling. That's physics. So we can get the temperature up to that point, and then it'll stay there while it melts, while it boils, and we can gently melt the chocolate. Doing this step first, because the chocolate then needs to cool back down after it's melted. Because there's going to be an egg yolk going in. Ooh, chocolate fingers. There's going to be an egg yolk going into the chocolate. I'm going to do this on the small burner. I already got the large pot out. To be perfectly accurate, I didn't put the large pot away from that pasta primavera I made yesterday. I just gave it a rinse out. Get us over to the stove. Then we just need to bring this to a boil. While that is coming up to temperature, I may as well separate my egg. Because once the egg is separated, eggs don't go bad instantly when you pop them open. They're pretty hardy things. A couple more glass bowls. Nice to have a variety of different sizes of mixing bowls. For example, I'm doing one egg white, ripping one egg white. Welcome in. Welcome to April. Get me back over to the countertop. I should put a. I said this last time, I think. I should put a countertop panel in the. Over here. Over here. So that if I'm over on the stove and I'm doing something on the counter, you can see that too. So I'm going to try separating this egg the proper way. Which is why you've got extra bowls. Because if you get any yolk in your white, it won't whip up properly. So I'm doing it in a separate bowl. Get it down to the bottom here. And you just gently knock it back and forth between the halves of the shell. Ideally, you've gotten better halves on your shell than I did. And the edge of the shell kind of peels the white away from the yolk. And then you got this little dangly bit that's always there that I never can get rid of, and I'm just gonna do it with my fingers. There you go. And then the yolk can sit to the side. Thankfully, I've got a recipe here that not only has me separate the egg, but uses both halves. It just uses them and then uses them separately and then puts them back together. Okay, that's separated. I just dirtied an extra bowl, but the white's going to end up in this one. Small bowl was, I guess, unnecessary. If you're doing more than one, having a staging bowl like that is a good idea, so that you don't spill yolk into your main dish. What I am making is two things, twofold. Chocolate and fish. We're making chocolate fish. No, we're making two things. I'm making a chocolate mousse. I was yesterday in Salberry's channel, she was talking about how she likes making chocolate mousse. I've never made chocolate mousse. And I don't know that I've ever had just chocolate mousse with a dessert. So that's what I'm going to try to make. And then I'm still working through my fish. So I am going to try making a seared tuna with a peppercorn cream sauce on pasta. But the dessert has to chill. So the dessert is being made first. It's going to go in the fridge. Then I'll work on the rest of it. And then in theory, the dessert will be ready to eat when dessert time comes. So, don't worry. I'm not literally covering tuna with chocolate. I thought about it. I honestly did think about how could I make something really nutty for April Fool. And I found a recipe for candied fish. The problem is it called for salmon, which I just used up yesterday. It called for a fatty fish, and I would have to get more, and I'm trying to use up the tuna. It also isn't a quick cook. It's a slow sugar cure. It's like fish jerky, but it's sweet fish jerky. I want to try it at some point, sure, but not this day. It is not this day. Where's my little spatula? Little spatula. So I'll put a pin in that one. We'll come back to that later. I'll make fish candy at some point. That'll be fun. Let's see, I should get out my various, while my water is heating up over there, I should just get out ingredients over here so they are handy. I know, you don't like fish, but okay, cream of tartar. Cream of tartar is, I'm pretty sure it's just tartaric acid in powdered form. But what it does is it helps the proteins in the egg white bind. So adding a little bit of tartaric acid makes whipping eggs easier. And since I'm doing a small amount here, I'm not using an electric mixer. I will be whipping this egg by hand. So we will see how long that takes. It may take a bit. In fact, I could probably get it started while that water is... Well, the water's starting to show little bubbles now, so I don't want to get too invested in this. It shouldn't have a problem with deflating once it's whipped up, so fingers crossed. And my powdered sugar, which is in the cupboard above everything here. Bought powdered sugar ages ago for something, and I put it in a big jar here because it comes in a bizarre... The tiny whisks right here. Felix is here. He came in up above. Anyways, so sugar, cream of tartar, whipped cream. I've got my heavy whipping cream. It is ultra pasteurized. But we're not curdling it, we're whipping it, so it should work fine. My water is bubbling, so I'm going to head over there. And let's melt us some chocolate. Oh, welcome in. We'll be bringing up two whisks today, since I'm whisking two things vigorously. But at the moment, I'm using the small burner, so it's really... Here's what I should be doing. Move that. Put you there. Better. Everyone can see it now. Welcome in. We're making chocolate and tuna. April's fools. Everyone's fooled. Now, chocolate melts pretty quickly, so... I gotta remember that this burner has been used today now and not put spatulas and stuff on it like I've done in the past. Because it'll still be warm for a while. As you can see, the chocolate's melting pretty well. It goes, once it starts, it goes pretty quick. Actually, can you see that? Turn the brightness up. It's dark on dark. Camera always wants to turn the brightness down on the stove because everything's white, so it's keying on all that white. But then it makes the dark colored things kind of vanish. So turn my temperature down a little bit there. Double boiler is doing its job. Not going past the boiling point, but I am boiling a little more vigorously than I think I initially wanted. The bowl's not actually hot, but it keeps shooting steam at my fingers, so I've got a hot pad as a barrier. I suppose my hand is constantly in the way when I'm doing this, too. And we're just going to go until it's runny and has no lumps. Heat of the bowl will keep it. Residual heat in the bowl will help keep it liquid for me while I do other things. And I need it to cool down anyways, because otherwise it will just scramble that egg yolk when I put it in there. Which wouldn't do it all. I'm not making chocolate scrambled eggs. Although, what do you guys think about chocolate scrambled eggs? I could make chocolate scrambled eggs. I hope you're all chatting a lot. I can't actually see the chat when I'm on this side. I'll catch up in a sec. Okay, I don't see any lumps. So, he's coming off. He's going to come over here and visit us on the stove. Get rid of that boiling water. Oh, it was, well, whatever. Since I'm boiling something later, I could have just put that boiling water in the bigger pot and saved myself some heating time, but whatever. Fish with chocolate. Why not fish with chocolate? Come on! Guys gotta... have an open mind. We're just... okay. Tiny Whisk is going to be employed for the egg white. Oops. Bam. I could make fish ice cream. I'm not making fish ice cream today, but I could make fish ice cream. I made bacon ice cream. You can put meat in ice cream. They call that a farce. This is going to take a bit. This is why you usually use an electric mixer for this type of thing. It takes a lot of elbow grease. And I have done it before, and it's time consuming. But you can see it's already starting to bubble. Refound this too much. These little wires will bend. This would also be awkward to do in it with a regular electric whisk, just because it's such a small volume. Hey, if you do this for a living, pastry chefs have jacked forearms. This is forearm workout city. Okay, we've got a good beginning of a foam going there. So I'm going to get out my quarter, that's an eighth, quarter teaspoon cream of tartar. The acid will help the egg whites bind, and you won't even notice the sourness once I've got it drowned in all of this powdered sugar and chocolate. Anyways, yes, Bookwoman is correct. I'm making two dishes today. One of chocolate, one of fish. So, the title is intentionally a bit clickbaity. Yeah, the volume is starting to increase as I whip air into it, so I might need to upgrade to the larger whisk as it grows. But doing eggs by hand always is time consuming. Doing cream is surprisingly much less time consuming than you think. It's just that it doesn't seem like it's doing anything until you get to, suddenly it turns into whipped cream. Just, oh, it's rough on the old, I don't know if this is any easier. Except that it's a little bit more sturdy, so I can kind of lean into it. Anyways, you can see how it's forming bubbles, and then the bubbles are staying. That's what we're going for. As you run the whisk through it, it forms more bubbles, and it breaks older, larger bubbles and makes many more smaller bubbles. And because it's got all the egg protein in there, it, they bind around the outsides of the bubbles, and it'll stay. Whew. Your arm gets tired doing this one. Ugh. And that's basically what whipping both eggs and cream does, is it just, it forms tiny bubbles, and then it causes those tiny bubbles to stay as bubbles. In eggs, it's pretty much 100% the protein, which is why you take the yolk out when you're doing a whipped egg like this. The fats in the yolk disrupt the ability of the proteins to bond. So if you get a little bit of yolk in your whipped, in your egg whites, and you try to whip them, they won't whip up quite right. It's coming along. Ooh, I gotta rest my arm a little bit. If only I was ambidextrous, I could switch and have my... left arm take some of the burden. But I can't. It just seems... it's awkward. I'm sure I could practice that and make it work, but... testing the temperature of my chocolate there. Egg is much harder to whip up than cream. So we're only going through this the long way here. I'm switching between a motion of going around and going back and forth. When I go back and forth, I'm rotating the bowl instead of the whisk. And that's pretty much to alleviate the muscles in my arm a little bit, because it's a different muscle for each of those motions. It's getting to my shoulder, guys. Oh. But it's coming along. We're getting a pretty dense foam. And it starts to sort of trail a little bit as I go. So it's working. It's just time consuming. No, I'm committed now. Besides, this is such a small bowl. I know I put the backseating allowed tag on, but I reserve the right to ignore your backseating. Once some sugar gets in it as well, that will help it to bind. And you know, not everybody has an electric mixer, so it's good to see how you do it when you don't, and that you can still be done the old-fashioned way. I spilled some. Get in there. Well, the bigger bowl is the one that has the chocolate in it, and the next bigger bowl than that is even bigger. And it's got acid in it, so I didn't really want to use a steel bowl. What, you're thinking that this is taking too long? I think this is how long it... We're going for soft peaks, and then I'm going to add the sugar. And then we're going for stiff peaks after the sugar's in. That's what the recipe says. That's what you get when I follow a recipe. Nonsense. I'm getting a... kind of a almost peak, little blob. Forms a little a peak in the actual stuff. This is a good time to chit chat with the viewers. How's April been going so far? Better than March? Don't worry, the cream won't take nearly this long. This is the single most time-consuming part of the entire project tonight. And as you can see, it's still runny, but it's starting to hold. Yeah! Yeah, April's been nice so far. We've had a good sunny day every day this month. I didn't get fooled by any jokes. And I saw no reason why it'll change for the rest of the month. So, there you go. Next time you've got a dessert that requires a whipped eggs. Remember, this is how they did it in the olden times, before the electric revolution. Except they are better at it than I am. I think we're getting there. So, I'm going to add the sugar. It's 2 tablespoons of powdered sugar. It just wanted me to get to... It says add slowly. I'm positive that the recipe I'm following expects me to be doing this in a, like, stand mixer. I believe the idea there is that you want the egg proteins already pretty well bound before you add anything to them. Basically, we're making meringue here, except we're not going to cook it. Yeah. That's working. It's working. Never fear. Boring, time-consuming process of whisking eggs. Rinse some of the sugar off my fingers so they don't get powdered sugar everywhere. Powdered sugar everywhere is how you get ants. Powdered sugar, well, all sugar, but powdered sugar, because the grains are so small especially, is very hydroscopic. So it absorbs water, grabs onto and bonds with water very, very well. That's how you make an icing. It's a tiny, tiny amount of liquid into a large quantity of powdered sugar, which is why it's called icing sugar. And the sugar, just like a, I made icing, my own icing once, and it came out too thick. It came out too runny because I thought it was going to be too thick because it was like a 1 tablespoon of milk to a cup of icing sugar. And it turned out much too runny when I added more, thinking that it was a mistake in the recipe. But, well, it's called icing sugar in lots of places. I think the package I bought was powdered sugar / icing sugar or confectioner's sugar or some such. You can see it's starting to form little divots as I run the whisk through, and then it falls back. Don't worry. I intentionally selected two things, one of which is going to be much more time-consuming than the other. Let's see how the temperature of my chocolate's doing. Chocolate's still runny. I'm going to finish whisking the... now that I've added the sugar and it's gotten larger, this could have probably gone in that bowl. Well, there's egg on my fingers. Hang on. I'm going to... I'm going to do a quick transfer to a larger bowl so I can really get some more oomph into it. And this larger bowl will probably be where I mix everything. Because I think that all the other ingredients end up getting added to the egg white anyways. And we'll need a folding spatula for that stage as well. Because you don't mix vigorously when you've got whipped cream and meringue. You gently fold, otherwise you knock all the air that you've spent an hour beating into it. Whew. And this is why every cooking show has one of those big stand mixers. Is for stuff like this. But as you can see, we've got runny peaks. I wonder if I should move up to the next size whisk. Hold up. Forgot about when I started was the fact that it increases in volume as I go. So that egg white that fit neatly in the little bowl is too large for the big bowl. Tell you what, if you're making this at home, if you're making along, go back to the start of the whisking and use an electric whisker instead of a hand whisk. Your shoulder will thank you. But we're getting proper, like, peaks now. So. Oh. My arm is tired. Thankfully, the entree step requires no arm strength. It occurs to me that you guys have been watching me whisk in this bowl, in this location, for what, half an hour? Nearly? I haven't been timing it. Probably not quite, but aha. So you can see, can you see? You can see we're developing a glossy sheen, and it's really holding its shape now. What's happened is sugar is helping with the glossy sheen part, but the bubbles are so small and so numerous that you can't see them anymore. If you can over whisk, eventually it starts forming lumps. With cream, if you over whisk it, it turns into butter. With egg white, I've never over whisked it because it takes so long to whisk it in the first place. But if I test it, I've got stiff peaks. They stick out, they hold their shape. That is what I was looking for. Okay. Oh, my arm hurts. We've got stiff peaks. I don't know. I'm not going to risk it now because it took so long to do that. We are going to... Well, my chocolate is actually cooled down to the point where it's at risk of starting to become thick. So I'm going to put my egg yolk in there and mix it in thoroughly. I don't know what this step does for the chocolate or the egg, but it's seizing the chocolate a little bit. Huh. We may have to return you to the double boiler. Just to loosen up. Because I think that egg yolk was just a little bit too cold. So let's get that water warming up. While that's heating up, that can sit on the side. And I can try doing the cream. Cream whips much faster than eggs do. The key difference being that when you go over with cream, it turns into butter, and when you go under, it just stays runny. Sorry, I'm opening the cream. It's a brand new container of cream. Opening it right off the side. You can't see it because my workspace is cluttered. Oh, that chocolate seized, didn't it? Damn. I don't think that was supposed to happen. Not completely seized, but it's much more seized than I was expecting. Let's see. I'm going to use another new whisk. I'm actually not using all that much cream here. Well, the chocolate's sitting here. I'm heating up the water over there so that I can re-mobilize it in just a bit. But whipping cream it'll just look like it's not doing anything for ages. Although much less ages than it took to do that one. And then all of a sudden, it'll just be whipped cream. At least that's my experience with it. Same premise here as the whipping the eggs, except this time, it's the fat content that is forming the bubbles, which makes them less stable. Whipped egg is a pretty stable substance. That's how you can make like baked meringues out of it. Heating it causes it to stay, to set in. Yes, all the whisks are coming out to play today. Heating your whipped eggs will cause it to set in place. Heating your whisked cream will cause it to immediately melt. This also wanted a bit of vanilla. I've got vanilla. Quarter teaspoon of vanilla. Which I should have gotten out ahead of time, so I'm not stopping midway. Oh, and my quarter teaspoon currently has acid dust on it, so I'm going to use the eighth and do it twice. I'm sticking to measurements because I'm spilling everything as well. Sticking to measurements because I don't know what I'm doing, because I've never done this before. And this feels like a tangential to baking. Just like with the eggs, the sugar should help the cream thicken up and bind. You wouldn't want to add acid to a whipped cream, though, because it will make the fats curdle rather than form a foam. See how much faster this one is. It's already forming a shapes. Sometimes I'll just make whipped cream myself, just as a topping for something I'm having, because it is honestly quite easy to do. Easy to spill. It's quite easy to make whipped cream out of heavy cream. I often have heavy cream because I use it in things. I actually use it in a lot more savory things than I use it in sweet things. Anyways, what we're going for here is, it's a soft peak. We're going for approximately the same thickness as the egg whites. So I'm looking for a stiff peak, but in this case, I want to make sure I don't go over, because if I go over, it'll start to form butter. And while butter is delicious, that's not what this is. Oh, speaking of butter, that's what I forgot in the chocolate. That's probably why it seized when I put the egg in there. There was supposed to be a tablespoon of butter in my chocolate. Well, it's a good thing I'm reboiling it then, because I'm going to have to add a tablespoon of butter. This is why you always read through your recipe twice. Because I read the ingredients, and I saw that there was butter on the ingredients. And then I didn't check to see where it was used. So there's that. Okay. The cream is whipped. The eggs are whipped. Make sure they're both holding. Since there's a bit of a delay now on the chocolate. I imagine that's why my yolk didn't quite incorporate as evenly as I had thought it was going to. The butter is probably there to loosen up the chocolate. So here's hoping. Oh, you've missed a lot of whisk action. This has been whisked. This has been whisked. We've transferred from small whisking bowls to larger whisking bowls. We've been whisking for an hour. And now I'm over here. Move the camera over on this side. Because I forgot to add the butter to my chocolate. and I think I may have seized the chocolate when I added the... Oh, God. Okay, this has to be done on the front burner because I need to be able to reach it, so... So, sorry guys, you're going to get the bad view because I need to be able to get at this one a little more firmly. And I can tell you that the melted butter, as it incorporates into the edges of the chocolate, is definitely loosening it back up. So, that's what I was missing. That's why it kind of seized a bit. Yes, hopefully the chocolate goes pretty quick. I just need to get it back to that runny state. It's already melted, and there's egg yolk in it. I don't really want to heat it a ton. And also, I don't want to have to wait for it to cool down again, so. I'm sure this is something you can do, like with a device that's specifically meant for it. Much easier than awkwardly propping a glass dish over the top of a tiny saucepan. Okay. Okay, the butter is incorporated. Chocolate is once again soft. I'm going to do perhaps a questionable thing. Because I've been having so much fun whisking. And it's a little grainy. It seems a little bit grainy still. I'm going to... And I think this will help it cool down because it'll put some air into it. I'm going to whisk that as well, just as it cools down. We're not looking for any particular end point. Just kind of get it to... Hello? Hello? It's, as you can see, it's holding itself together in a way that is not... a lot like melted chocolate. Wow, it is not the texture that I think it's meant to be. Huh. What do you think? Oh, you can't even see it. You're on the wrong screen. Somebody's got to say when I'm over here. Look at this. It's like a brownie. It's really not acting like melted chocolate at all. Like, what the heck? And it just gets stuck in the whisk, like, immediately. But it was all seized up before I even put it back over there. I think it seized when I put the yolk in it. Well, this is annoying because this is the last step is to put these three things together. I just did that. I was just over there melting it again. If it's doing this because the egg yolk is cooked, then putting more heat in it is not gonna fix that. It's just gonna cook the egg yolk more. I probably have to start over on the chocolate. That's up. Pisser. Well, thankfully I did buy more chocolate. But now it was supposed to be cooling down while I was doing all the whisking. This is supposed to be an easy thing to make. So the fact that I'm having trouble with it bugs me. Makes me unhappy. Feels like a waste of chocolate, too. Can I do with seized chocolate? That's the next project. Today, I guess. What do you do with weird, seized, eggy chocolate? Is why I don't make desserts. We're switching to a steel bowl this time because I no longer have an appropriately sized glass bowl that isn't already full of stuff. The chocolate doesn't have any acids in it, so I don't think we'll have a problem with reacting with the bowl. So there shouldn't be any issues using a steel bowl. Doesn't look as nice. I'm just going to move that cutting board out of the way. Okay. Bit of a snafu. Remember to put the butter in right away so it can incorporate properly. Also, I'm gonna have to separate another egg because I need another yolk. Then I'm gonna have an extra white. That I don't know what to do with. Googling a little bit. Google says you can make it without egg yolks. It's a different recipe. Yeah, I know what causes seizing. It's just that I didn't think it would seize then. I'm going to not add the yolk since it seized when I added the yolk the first time. But yeah, I know what causes seizing. I just didn't think it would seize when I added an egg yolk to it. And I'm betting it's because it has something to do with the fact that the butter wasn't in there from the start. And I'm going to do it on a lower temperature now, too. Because we don't need to hard boil this. So I'm just going to do it without the yolk, since I think the yolk was just a added bonus richness thing anyways. So, since I'm wasting some time, I will also get my next thing started, which is boiling the large pot of water for some noodles. Because I'm also making an entree, although the entree is significantly less involved than this dessert item. This is so awkward. Such an awkward angle with me up here at the top, but I'm not going to use the large burner for the chocolate, and I don't want to use that. That's so awkward to reach over there for that back burner. So, unfortunately, the chocolate is going to have to be done here on the front burner. Double check that my eggs and cream aren't deflating on me. Small amount of boiling water while whisking like crazy to unseize. Tell you what, I'm gonna melt this one fully. And then set it aside. And then I will attempt to do that with this guy while that one is cooling down. Because I will be more able to save and reuse that chocolate if I end up not needing it than this chocolate if I end up not needing it. Because this one has the egg yolk in it. This is the one that I don't know what else to do with. So that's the that's what we're doing. Half the fun of all of this is getting it wrong and learning your lesson. Okay, this is fully melted. Countertop. Okay, this guy is fully melted. It needs to cool before I can do anything with it either way, so otherwise it'll just cook my eggs there. So it's going to sit here. Well, it's going to sit to the side there. Move some things. Get this guy in the front. We'll see if we can't save this with just a small dab of boiling water, since I've got boiling water on the go. Oh, man. It's a good thing the entree that I am going with is going to take, I want to say, less than 20 minutes. So that's good. Have a nice sort of dynamic, fast cooking ending to all this madness and nonsense. I just need to practice doing sweets more often because clearly they're much more fiddly and I have much less experience with sweets. I'm cleaning some things up here. I don't need that knife anymore. I don't think I need that tiny whisk anymore. Measuring spoons, the quarter cup. I've got this whisk. Okay. Yes, confectionery is sneaky, but I didn't think that a mousse was a confection, so it caught me off guard. Boiling water. Teaspoon of boiling water. Well, that didn't super work. It's a little bit softer, but it's still doing that soily potting soil thing, which is trouble. I wish I had another metal whisk. Have all the whisks are occupied at the moment. I wish I had the big metal whisk from the whipped cream for this. I can have the big metal whisk from the whipped cream for this if I want to. Since I'm adding water to it, I'm not super worried about the whisk being completely dry. That's probably too much water. Hey, that's doing something. Alright, I'm transferring between things quickly and without regard. Hot. Oh. Okay, well. Dish towel got in the chocolate. So that's fun. I do not think that quite worked. I think I might be able to force it if I keep doing this. But I think I'm changing what I'm making now from chocolate to soup. It's melted. It's remelted. Well, huh. Teaspoon was not enough water. I needed about 1/8 cup. Couple of tablespoons, but I think that might have worked. It's still hot. It's looking about the consistency it was when I started before I seized it by mistake. It's got more volume than the other one. The other one is thicker. This one's a little runnier. If I get out a spoon, two spoons. That one holds. That one. So the other one is definitely thicker, but it's not dramatic. I'm going to go with this one. And I will save the backup one. We're moving ahead with the original chocolate, because I got it to a consistency that I think I can combine it with the stuff. I'm pretty sure the goal here is for it to just be liquidy enough that you can combine it with the whipped ingredients. The whipped cream, looking a little flat. The whipped egg is just takes a quick rebeat to return to stiff peaks. My pasta water is boiling. So the other thing I'm making today, don't forget we had two projects today. Noodles. They are going in the boiling water with some salt. Bring it down from high to medium high so it doesn't boil over on me. Let's wrap a few things up here. Okay, well, I used more chocolate than I expected to. The other melted chocolate, I think I can come up with a secondary plan for. Let's see, I don't have any graham crackers. I don't have any kind of cookies or anything I could crush up. Gonna make this into a little tart. I could pour it on the tuna. You joke, but I could do it. What's to stop me? Okay. Pasta's boiling. Oh my god, one of these bugs. Sorry, I've been inundated with box elder bugs. One of them just showed up in the kitchen, so we are disposing of him. I hardly ever see him on this end of the house. That one showed up. Anyways, the other thing I'm making, and again, it's going to go comparatively quick. I'm just making sure that I'm doing all this in a decent order, because the chocolate needs to cool before I add it to the rest of this stuff. So they're going to hang out at the top edge there. I guess I don't need that knife anymore. Tuna. It's a pretty small piece. One of those sections from the sushi. I picked the thickest one because I want it to be red in the middle when I'm done. This one is also a recipe, but it's a much looser recipe. This is the kind of cooking that I'm good at. I'm covering it in sesame oil, just a little bit. Make the surface wet, but not wet with water. It's been sitting over there that whole time on the side, drying itself out. I also patted it down with paper towel before we started. But oil the surface to get my crust to stick. My crust is peppercorn sesame. Peppercorn, that's paprika. That's bay leaf. That's thyme. Peppercorns. Which I will be crushing up in the mortar. Make sure I've got enough. Along with some sesame seeds. Oops. A little bit of a lot of sesame seeds. I don't want a real fine grind. I just want them to be kind of crushed. Since there's sesame in here, I don't want to crush it too hard either, or this will start to turn oily. Make sure there's no whole peppercorns in here, because while tasty, they are tricky to bite down on. Okay. Make sure that the top is also oiled. Speaking of oil, my pot on the back burner. Oh, it's just stopped. Putting a dab of oil in there because it keeps trying to foam up. And neutral oil in my fry pan. Heat on. Okay. Both sides are coated in my peppercorn sesame mix. I'm not going to do the outer edges. Just going to kind of dab it around. Pick up some of these lost ones and get them stuck on there. Who would have expected the chocolate would be such a complicated thing? Who could ever have predicted this? Okay, let's get us over to the stovetop, because we are coming up to the fun part. Gosh, for all that faffing about with the chocolate, I'm honestly pretty well on schedule with my normal I just noticed that my follower count went up. Did somebody follow me and I wasn't looking? Well, whoever followed me, thank you. Anyways, we're waiting for the oil to become hot over here because I'm just going to do a... I think it's going to be a 1 minute sear on each side. It's going to be really fast. And hot. Fast and hot is what we're shooting for here. So I want to make sure that the oil is hot, hot, hot before I even start. The goal here is to get the tuna just seared on either side, but still pretty much red raw in the middle. And then I'll set it aside to rest while I construct a little sauce in the same pan using some of that heavy cream and some more pepper. There's a lot of pepper in this. I'm basically making a steak pan sauce, but I'm using tuna and I'm serving it on pasta. Which reminds me, I need to get out a plate to receive those noodles when they are ready, which should be any moment now. And a... what, the colander? I'll just use the scooper. Okay, my oil is shimmering, which is the sign for me to do the thing. Immediate sizzle when I put it down. 1:38:39. All right, that was just me looking at the time. I will be flipping it after a minute. I'm taking the pasta out. It formed knots. Delightful. Okay. Pasta's out. Turn that burner off. Get out my tongs for a quick flip. I kind of want to flip it now. Oh, that's the right time. That's a minute. So, I don't think my pan is as hot as they use when they do a seared tuna at like a restaurant, but it is still pretty ripping hot. How's everyone been? Oh, somebody dropped out. I asked that earlier, but okay, Tuna, get out of there. You can rest on top of the noodles for now. Okay. Scraping in the remaining peppercorns and sesame seed. And a little bit smoky. A little bit smokier than I think I wanted. A splash of alcohol. Loosen up that stuff that was stuck to the bottom and bring the temperature of the pan down a little bit. Yeah. It's burning. Something's burning. Because I'm getting like actual acrid smoke, not just a pepper. Huh. I think my smoke alarm is going to go off soon at this rate. Again, I've rough crushed some peppercorns, and now I'm adding that pan is too hot. Is what's happening? Yeah, so what happened there was the pan was too hot. So I'm pretty sure the smoke was coming from the oils burning in the pan, which isn't the greatest thing. A little bit of my pasta water. Starches will help form a sauce, as always. So I may end up with a little bit of burned flavor in here. Turn that all the way off and just ride on residual heat as it kind of thickens up. I'm going to take my tasting spoon, lick the chocolate off of it, and see if that's burnt or not. Little toasty. Came out a little toasty. Okay, that heat is off. I'm coming back over to here because the chocolate on this side is pretty much cool to the touch. But it's still glossy and liquidy, which is what I'm looking for. Egg. Deflated just a little bit, but I can fix that. And the whipped cream Looks about the same. And at this point, we're getting rid of the whisk. There. And the chocolate. Because we don't whisk these together. We've worked all that air into them. Eat very carefully. Chocolate on my fingers. I can't quite get them to my mouth without touching the microphone. So I don't want to dump the chocolate directly on the top of this. I want it to come sort of be on the side. And then we scoop and fold. Scoop and fold. Scoop and fold. And then the same thing with the whipped cream. This part, folding things together that you've whipped up, I know how to do from the times I've made ice cream. It's very similar to my method of making ice cream. This makes a lot. This recipe was for one? This recipe was supposed to be chocolate mousse for one. That's a lot of chocolate mousse. I feel like this makes at least two. And we just, I'm sort of drifting off the side here. We swoop and fold until we have it all one nice even color. Okay. Okay. Let's take a look at my cream sauce. It's not the nicest cream sauce I've ever made. I think my pan was too hot and I burned my peppercorns. But we'll make do. I got a fancy glass here to fancy glass up my mousse, but I think it's not going to all fit in that fancy glass. I'm going to need at least another fancy glass. It's very light, but it's holding its shape. And it tastes good. Don't worry, I haven't forgotten about the tuna. It's resting. Here, you can't see this well from the top. Take a gander at that. It needs to firm up in the fridge, so I'm going to do that right quick. Get it in there. And I'm gonna put something on the over the top of it just to keep it from drying out. I've got another one here. I guess I'm gonna have to put them in little ramekins. I know what I'll do. Scratch the ramekins. All of the remainder can go into the small Pyrex, put a lid on it, and then I can have it tomorrow. Because it says, feel free to chill overnight. Where's my spatula? Don't want any of this to go to waste. Now the chilling process should cause it to seize up into a little bit more, or set up into a little bit more of a like a almost jello consistency. Not quite, like a very soft. It should be very soft and airy, but it should like hold up. You could take a scoop of it and it won't run. Okay, well that ultimately, despite our little snafu, worked. This is why it's so nice to have live audience. Somebody could you can clue me in to a trick to salvage my chocolate. Okay, with the dessert in the fridge, we're a little bit off schedule there. Because I'm immediately jumping over to prepping the, or finishing off the entree, which the original idea was that I would finish the dessert and then start the entree. There's our, oops. All right, I've cleaned up the countertop. There's our crusty salmon. Not salmon, tuna. And my plate of pasta. Which to start with, I'm adding some of my pepper sauce right on top of the pasta. Which will help it not stick together. We're reserving just a little bit of the pepper sauce. Because here's my plan. Now, you're supposed to cut this across the grain like you would with a steak. But I can't remember where the grain is because now I've cooked it. I think it was this way. So, we should be taking a nice slice of this. Flop it open. It should be nice and bright red inside. It's just a little rim of that seared edge. And it should work all the way across. Okay, now that one wants to break at the flake instead of cut apart, so it's a good sign that it's cooked. Yeah, I'm a big fan of the tuna. I think if you treat it right, for a little while I was completely off of tuna. Like, tuna is bad for the environment because the way tuna is fished is terrible. But I think if you treat tuna like a nice piece of meat and respect it, you can feel okay about eating it. So I'm paying extra for nicer tuna, and then I'm treating it right, as opposed to like canned tuna. And get my sauce. Yes, tuna. Treat tuna like you would a steak. Not like tuna salad. Well, the sauce is a little bit lumpy, so. Get this out of the way, and voila! Black pepper, sesame crusted, seared tuna steak over vermicelli with a peppercorn cream sauce. It's getting a little bit blown out by the camera there. If I put something dark on the side here, it'll sharpen up. Put something dark right there, it sharpens up the camera. That and the chocolate mousse. I'm out of parsley. You know, I didn't grab any extra parsley. This would be a perfect situation for a little sprig of parsley. I think I can zhuzh it up with a sprig of thyme. Doesn't look as nice, but I've got a lot of thyme. Ha. Time doesn't quite look as nice. As always, I want to make sure to get some pictures of this before I dive in on it. The curse of producing food for entertainment. You don't get to eat it right away. I don't have any delicious cilantro. That is a good idea. We're gonna take the fancy food over to my photo station. Clean it up a little bit. I'm not adding cheese because I don't think cheese and tuna go well together. Sorry, I'm being quiet because I'm concentrating on getting good angles. Taking a bunch of photos so I can pick the best one. Okay, let's bring it back and then I'll taste it And then I can go, yeah, I ruined it. I need a fork. I probably don't need a knife. We'll get out a knife just in case the tuna needs to be cut, but I don't think it will. Grab a little bit of the pasta. Immediately destroy my artful presentation. Pasta tied itself into some weird knots in the pot. Hey. Mm. Mm. Okay. It's got a lot of black pepper in it. But it doesn't hit you. The black pepper has been sort of softened. I probably think probably by cooking it in the cream. So it comes on slow. Honestly, it needs a little bit of salt. I need to taste a piece of the tuna without the rest of it on there. Okay. The tuna firms up a little bit. It still has that fresh flavor in the middle, but it's got some crunch from the peppers and seeds on the outside that have become toasted. It's really nice. This is really nice. That's a good Friday dinner. And for all the faffing about, don't have as much cleanup as I did on Tuesday for that sushi. which is shocking. Two pots and a bunch of whisking bowls. Well, I can't show you the finished product of the mousse until it's had a chance to chill for a bit. So you're gonna have to make do with that preview. I'll take glamour shots of it once it's chilled and ready to go. And then I'm going to go eat this while it's still warm. And I also... We are in the wrapping up phase now. I know exactly where I'm going to... Here, let me take back to my smiling face. I know exactly where we're raiding today. Because I stumbled upon a stream who... She was playing The Dig, a classic LucasArts point-and-click adventure that I love. Game from my childhood. So I'm going to go watch her while I eat my dinner. And as such, I'm going to drop my stream off there as well. So let's go. I'll let that... we're going to go visit Jen the Human. I don't have really any raid messages. So I guess just say hi when you get there. I should come up with some kind of raid message at some point, but... you could shout spoon. We could all shout spoon. Anyways, she's playing the dick. She's pretty late into it, so if you have any interest in playing this 20-year-old LucasArts game, spoilers, but honestly, I just love the game a ton. She seems like a sweet, nice person, good streamer. So, positive vibes from what I saw. I'm happy to drop some love off. And then I will be watching while I eat. I'll say hi, and then I'll settle down to dinner. Regular time next week, Tuesday and Friday. Thanks for hanging out. Catch you next time.